Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. We have apologies today from Jackie Dunbar, and we are also joined by Bob Dorris, who is attending as a substitute member for the SNP. Welcome, Bob, again. This is our first public meeting since the deputy convener, Fiona Hislop, left us to take up her new role as Transport Minister. I believe the committee, and I'm sure we all agree, the committee benefited greatly from Fiona's experience in government and the diligence with which she sat on this committee with, and I'm sure we would all agree that we wish her well in her new role. There are lots of things to deal with, so I think I'm glad that we've got that on record. The first item on the agenda, therefore, is a decision in taking business in private. We have consideration whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Item 5 is consider the evidence we'll hear under agenda item 2. And item 6 is to consider our work programme. Are we all agreed to take these items in private? We are agreed. Agenda item 2 is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Net Zero and Just Transition on the Scottish Government's priorities relevant to the committee's remit. As we head into summer recess, this is a wide-ranging session to help the committee understand what the new Cabinet Secretary's priorities will be, not only in the coming months, but over the remainder of the parliamentary session. We're going to explore the biggest challenges I hope that she will face during this time. So I'm pleased to welcome Mari McCallum, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Net Zero and Just Transition. Philip Raines, the Deputy Director of Domestic Climate Change from the Scottish Government. David Signorini, the Director of Environment, Forestry and Scottish Government. Annabel Turpey, the Director for the Marine Directorate, Scottish Government, and Alison Irvine, the Chief Executive for Transport Scotland. Thank you, all of you, for accepting our invitation. And before we begin, Cabinet Secretary, I believe you wish to make a short opening statement.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I will do. I should say, first of all, that although having deprived the committee of Fiona Hislop, I am very glad to welcome her back to this side of the House and in her role as Minister for Transport. Very pleased to be with you today. In all the evidence that the committee takes, you will be aware that we face a number of challenges just now as a country and more broadly. But for my part, the climate and nature emergencies are front and centre of the challenges that we face. It's the, as I see it, the collective fight of our lifetime, and this portfolio is really centred on that. It is a vast portfolio, as you'll see from the number of directors that I have with me and equally the number of junior ministers that take forward work on a daily basis across the portfolio. I suppose just a reflection to start with, this is the first time that Net Zero and Just Transition have come together at Cabinet level. For me, that represents my work in being both rising to the imperative of climate change and equally doing that in a way that recognises that the scale and pace of change is quite extraordinary and that we have to make sure we're taking decisions that are fair for economy and society. If I can just run through some very headline priorities before we get into discussion. On the net zero front, we are halfway there, but the hardest part lies ahead. And obviously one of the big significant staging posts that we have in the coming months is the publication of the draft climate change plan, which we are working on furiously. On transport, of course, this is the largest source of our emissions. Public transport is a key driver of our net zero goals. It needs to be available, attractive, affordable. And, of course, that's one of my priorities as well. So too is decarbonising transport, and we're working with COSLA on the 20% route map just now. On heat and buildings, we're taking steps to decarbonise new buildings, and we'll shortly publish consultation on proposed bill measures to regulate both efficiency and heating sources. The portfolio also covers biodiversity, the twin crises, and my colleague Lorna Slater is taking forward a lot of work there, including on a biodiversity strategy, natural environment bill. She also leads day-to-day on the circular economy and is taking forward work on a circular economy bill, on a litter and fly tipping strategy, among others. Marine protection also comes within the portfolio, and I know we've had many discussions about highly protected marine areas, but of course it's broader than that. We also have the MPA network and others besides. And just penultimate point, just transition is the thread that runs through the whole portfolio. As I say, a significant change agenda is before us on account of the emissions reduction targets that the Parliament has set. And actually, more importantly, in the face of the climate and nature emergency that we face. But we have to make sure the decisions we take are fair, take communities with us and learn lessons from the past. And we're seeking to do that through both our discussion papers and the final Just Transition plans to accompany all of that work. But more needs to be done. Convener, it's a very, very busy, it's a very busy area. Very happy to answer questions on the vast scope of the transport net zero and just transition portfolio.
I think the vastness of your portfolio is fully understood by this committee, who
you will, yes, you will
have a vast remit as well, and sometimes we struggle to get round to every single part of it. But we'll have a go today, and I think Ash is starting off with the first questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. So, given that the annual emission reduction target for 2021 was missed, and that Scotland has now missed 8 out of 12 annual targets for emissions reduction, how confident are you that the 2030 interim target can still be achieved?
Thank you, Ash. So I think it's a good point. We have to always assess the progress that we're making, as well as looking forward to the next targets. Just last week, I made a statement to Parliament on the 2021 target, which we missed by 1.2%. And I think that, you know, that said to me two things. One, that in the year 2021, we were tracking quite closely where our world-leading targets dictate that we need to be, which is 1.2% behind where we needed to be for that year. And I think that's a positive thing, albeit I would have loved to have met the target. But the other thing it tells me is, of course, that there is so much work still to be done. And in all candour, that is increasingly the case as we move to the 2030 target. I wasn't in Parliament at the time when the last Climate Act was set, but those who were will remember that the Committee on Climate Change were quite clear that they didn't recommend the 75% 2030 target. I think it was changed at stage three and with cross-party consensus, I should say. So my view very much is that it is exceptionally challenging, but we have to do everything we can, and that by aiming high, I think we will get very close to where we need to be in the shorter term, and I'm very confident of the long-term progress at the mid-century 2045 point.
OK, so coming on to progress. So the CCC progress report for Scotland at the end of last year, they said that they didn't see evidence of sufficient action in order to meet the stated ambitions, and that the Scottish Government's own monitoring report finds that there's more than twice as many policy indicators on track than off track. How can that be? Are these indicators actually fit for purpose?
Thank you. I might come to my colleague Phil to say something about the monitoring report and the comparison of that with the CCC report. What I would say for my part is that I welcome the CCC's guidance throughout, and including their paper published in December last year on our progress on mitigation. I published my response to that last week when I made the statement on emissions reduction for 21. We accepted 98 of the 99 recommendations, the latter being entirely reserved and not in our gift. I think that things have moved on somewhat since the CCC's report in December to where we are now. We've done a number of things. We have, for example, my colleague Marie Goujon has made progress on the vision for agriculture and the decarbonisation of food production and move to regenerative farming. So I think that means that we have moved on from where we were when the CCC first published their report. We've also, in our policy prospectus, we've upped our commitment to peatland restoration in the near term. And of course, we're taking forward work on the 20% car kilometres reduction route map. So if the question is, compared with where we are now, with what the CCC said in December, I accept what the CCC said, but equally there has been movement since then in what the government have taken forward. Phil, but I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that.
Yes, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. One way we are looking at the way that the CCC responded and criticised the Scottish Government in December, which used very similar language, I note that they criticised the UK Government in their report in June. So we are, as an aside, we are very much looking forward to what their response is, what their review is of the UK Government's progress, which is due in the next week or so, I believe. It's not so much the lack of tangible progress so much as, well, what are you going to do next? You make commitments, for example, around 20% car kilometer reductions. Where's the detail in this? What this is coming forward? And when we've done the monitoring report, we've always been clear, as was set out in the updated climate change plan, which is the existing climate change plan that we're operating on, that there we have these ambitions, we have these absolute kind of far-reaching goals that we're trying to reach under the different sectors, and that there was work that would need to be done to set out the precise detail of how we're going to be doing that. And one of the ways we read the Climate Change Committee's report in December is, in a sense, they're saying, where is that detail? Where, you know, we need to see how far, you know, we need to see where the next stage is going to be. So it's very much, in our view, a forward-looking report. The monitoring report that we produced for May, which is based around our progress on what we said we're going to do in the updated climate change plan, is very much focused on where we are now. So I guess if there's a difference in view, I guess a difference in perspective, the monitoring point is looking at where we are now. The Climate Change Committee, one way to read it is to say, we're less interested in that. We're more interested in the critical detail you're going to need to put in place to be able to say how we're going to get to 2030. And as the Cabinet Secretary has said, that critical detail is going to be forthcoming, and we accept the Climate Change Committee's pressure on us, if you will, to come forward with that. The big areas where, just as maybe an aside, three big areas which the Climate Change Committee has noted that further work was needed, and bear in mind this report was in December, was one area was agriculture. And you'll note that the detail on how the Scottish Agricultural Programme, the route map for that, was published in February. So we have come forward with more detail about how we're going to get to meet our obligations or commitments within the climate change plan, but also what the Climate Change Committee was asking for. And the two other big areas are heat and buildings and the particularly the 20% car kilometre reduction, the route map. And those are areas which... again, to borrow the Cabinet Secretary's word, we are furiously working on to provide that detail in the coming months and being able to set that forward.
Okay.
Sorry, that was a long answer, but I hope that gives some detail.
Thank you. Convener.
Okay, just before we move on to the next question, Cabinet Secretary, could you just tell me, I mean, during 2021, we were still struggling to come out of the pandemic, and it was a struggle. And emissions would have naturally been lower because less people were travelling, less people were moving around, and less things were happening. So the fact that you narrowly missed the target with that in mind, is it going to make the next target more difficult to reach?
I think it's a balance. So we were having a discussion about this as well. And I should say from the outset that when I presented the 1.2 percent miss, I was very clear about why we thought that was the case. It was a rebound in transport emissions, exactly as you say, following a year of lockdown in 2020. And it was about, I think, one of the coldest winters in a decade that we'd had, which meant that emissions from heating our homes was higher. I was thinking to myself in 2022, had transport largely settled? Were people not using transport because of fear of COVID, or was there a behavioural change that had started to set in? And, for example, the way that people travel to work, people's lifestyles have changed. So I don't know, basically, as the answer to what extent that return to transport emissions will continue to be seen into 2022. I think there will be some. I think we might see some aviation rebound in that as well. But I also would like to think that one of the positives from the pandemic, amid a plethora of incredible negatives, was that lifestyle did change in respect of how, for example, people travel to work. And I hope, therefore, that we will hold on to some of those changes in the 2022 results. And, of course, all the time, we are seeking to bring forward policies which can make the change now and be borne out in future targets.
I think what we have seen, though, Cabinet Secretary, is more people moving back to trains and hopefully more people back to buses. But that will definitely increase the emissions if more people are using those transports. So it is going to be a problem as you encourage them to use trains and public transport to get the balance right. So on that note, I think that there's a huge amount. I'm going to move straight to the next lot of questions, which come from Mark.
Thanks. Morning, everybody. Can I ask you just about the launch date then for the climate change plan? Are we still on track for November for that?
Yes, it's still my aim to lay a draft with the Parliament in November.
Right. OK, great. And then just to go back to the points I think Phil was raising around, critical detail. I mean, that was a feature of UKCCC's comments there. Can you just sort of explain that a little bit more? So when it comes to individual policies that will be listed in the climate change plan, will it be really clear what the expected reduction in emissions will be, what any underlying modelling is behind that, what assumptions have been used? Because I think with previous climate change plans, it's been almost impossible to see what's been going on behind the assumptions. And I think particularly with the use of the Times modelling, previous cabinet secretaries have said, well, it's incredibly complex. We couldn't explain it to you because it's all a big computer model. So I'm just wondering, kind of, for people who are looking through this, particularly sectors that are going to have to make quite big reductions in emissions, going to have to respond to the opportunities around heat and other areas, kind of how clear is it going to be, this plan?
Thanks, Mark, and I will come to Phil on that as well. I suppose, for my part, I see the Times model as a well-regarded, exceptionally rigorous tool, which is critical to our ability to plan sector envelopes for emissions reduction. But equally, it's a model, and therefore we have to apply human judgment to a lot of what it might throw up to us as being the least cost pathway to net zero. So, that's the job that myself and the civil servants will do, to apply that human judgment to what Times tells us. And I think that we will be as explanatory and transparent about that as we possibly can. And actually, one of the great benefits of this strand of work is that we do have a tangible measurement in emissions reduction, which we can, with great detail, set out, the emissions reduction policy that's expected to run with a policy. Compare that to something like biodiversity gain. It's quite different. So where we have that quite tangible measurement, I'm keen that it's as clear as possible what each policy accrues to. But I'll hand over to Phil, whose days are probably filled with this very much just now.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So the legislation is clear that when we put out the climate change plan, we have to say what the policies are, what the costs and benefits are, and our intention is to set out exactly how it's going to be building on those emissions. With all these things, there are going to be assumptions, because you're making guesses on technological developments, on behavioral change. You're drawing on a field where there is differences of views, and that's one reason why we are seeking to speak to as many people as possible. The Cabinet Secretary chairs a climate change plan advisory group that pulls in individuals, as you well know yourself, to be able to represent that diversity of view. But the plan needs to be very clear about how all these things work. There are some things we're going to have to make our best guesses about things, and some of them are to do with the intentions of others. I think it probably goes without saying that the achieving our climate change targets is just as much as we, the UK government, needs the Scottish Government and the action of Scotland to be able to achieve their national, their UK-wide targets. We need them and would expect them to be able to provide contributions for our plan, particularly for areas where there, many of the powers are already reserved, such as we call it, the industry envelope. So we will need to make those assumptions and things, but that's the November document is the starting point for that discussion. It's the starting point for the discussion with Parliament, and it's the starting point for that discussion with the public, with stakeholders. And then over the next, I think, is it 18-month period, or however long it is, to March 2025, that debate will go on about our assumptions and things, what have you. But we need to be as clear as possible about that. Times is part of that, but times is a tool. Yeah. So, you know, if you're looking at the way a house is being made, it's good to understand what the workmen and, you know, have used for the tools and things, what have you. But it's probably the quality of the work that is probably the essential thing there.
Okay. I mean, I think with previous plans, it's been very difficult to understand some sectors because there's just been a lack of data, a lack of information. And it's felt, perhaps rightly or wrongly, when it comes to, say, farming, land use, because there is a lack of data there and a lack of clarity as to what individual actions will do in terms of reduction of carbon emissions, certain sectors have kind of almost been given a buy, almost kind of left off a little bit. Whereas other sectors like transport, it's very clear, or heat and buildings or whatever, you know, it's very clear what certain actions will do in terms of reduction of carbon emissions. How do we sort of bring the data up to a point where we can understand exactly what's happening across different sectors and exactly what different measures will achieve? Because there seems to be some areas a bit of a fuzziness around, you know, you make that change, well, it might result in X, but we're not exactly sure.
Phil, you should certainly come back in on this. I would just add, I would begin by saying that it certainly doesn't feel to us like any sector is being given a buy. This, I mean, when Ms. Regan was asking about the the long-term targets, the stretch and the pressure that our targets place on every sector across our economy can't be understated. You know, I take your point about how we set that against each other, and I'll bring Phil in. I think that I just wanted to draw out two points that he made as well, though, which is that when you're making policy out to 2040 in a fast-paced area where we require innovation to come to our aid, you have to be able to give some scope to technological advance and, as Phil said, actions that UK government might take. And you mentioned agriculture. I strongly take the view that technological advance will come to our aid to an extent in the decarbonisation of agriculture. And some of them are in train now, and we can allude to them and we can build them in. Some of them will undoubtedly come on track before 2040, and we don't even know about them yet. Hmm. But, Phil.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just to build on that, there is absolutely no sector that is going to be, I don't know if the record can capture scare quotes, but there you go, or we'll be protected as such. I think every sector, just as climate change affects the whole of Scotland, right away across every community, every sector, every individual. So the work to address climate change is going to affect everyone. Okay. So I don't want to use words like sacrifice, because part of the beauty of the legislation, I use that word deliberately, is putting this idea of just transition in, which is it shouldn't be seen as sacrifice, it shouldn't be seen as the loss of the world we had. It should be seen as embracing the change to ensure that Scotland gets the full benefit of it, which is one of the reasons why it's one of the three key goals in the policy perspectives. But to pick up the point of fuzziness, there is a there will be some fuzziness on some of the on some of the data, because of the complexity and the state of where the research is. Peatland is a great one. Yeah. Our understanding of peatland emissions is changing monthly.
Yep.
So, thank you.
Okay, thanks for that. So last area then that I just want to ask you about is negative emissions technology. So BECCS, CCS, again, Climate Change Committee highlighted that there's continuing uncertainty around that, and recommended, I think over a year ago now, 2 years ago, that there should be a plan B. I mean, very challenging, but how do you respond to that?
It is very challenging, and it returns to that point that I was trying to make previously, which is that no stone can be left unturned. So therefore, if for whatever reason a significant stone like CCUS cannot be overturned by the Scottish Government and we require intervention from UK Government, that makes it very difficult, because there really isn't scope across other sectors of the economy to compensate for that. So what I can do in my role is continue to work with UK Government colleagues, including through the Net Zero IMG, to impress upon them the necessity that CCUS, the ample scope that we have for it in Scotland, is brought on track as soon as possible. It is mission critical for the decarbonisation of industry. And the CCC have been very clear about it's not a nice to have, it's an essential, and I share that view. So continue to push on CCUS. There has obviously been positive movements of late. I need a timescale for when Track 2 is going to be complete, in particular for my planning for the climate change plan. We've also been trying to take forward other forms, so the bioenergy and CCS. We have we've set up a working group to look at that and trying to progress it as much as possible. But I think if the question is, do we compensate for that elsewhere? It's very difficult to do. Mm-hmm. Very difficult.
Okay.
Thanks. Just a couple of housekeeping points, just if I may. Just first of all to remind, because somebody's talked about agriculture getting a buy, just to remind the committee that I do have an interest in a agricultural holding in the form of a family farm, which we run and operate. I do have trees on that farm, in case we get onto trees, and I do have houses on that farm. As well, which I let out, just so there's no dubiety, and I'm not trying to cut anyone off. The other thing, just to remind people, is you, if you're a witness, you certainly don't need to push the button on your microphone. In fact, if you push the button on your microphone, it probably turns it off when we're trying to turn it on. So leave it alone. We'll make sure it happens, and we make sure that everyone can hear your dulcet tones. And he says with a smile, if you move your microphone away and you suddenly get to speak, then we won't be able to hear you. I'm not looking at anyone in particular. On that note, the next questions come from Liam.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. In 2019, the Scottish Government published its second adaptation programme, the Climate Ready Scotland. Now, in March 2022, the Climate Change Committee's progress report noted that progress in delivering adaptation has stagnated. Now, that was 15 months ago. So what work has been done to address that stagnation, Cabinet Secretary?
Thank you for the question. Very pertinent that we should discuss adaptation following mitigation. So you'll be aware of SCAP 2, our plan for adaptation in Scotland, 170 policies contained within that, most of which are within my direct responsibility. We have flood risk within that is obviously one of the greatest challenges that Scotland faces in terms of adaptation. We've been funding that to the tune of £42 million a year and continue to do that. We've also made more funding available, £158 million over the course of this Parliament, to be distributed to manage flood risk in Scotland. We also fund coastal erosion work, which I know is of interest to Mr Kerr and to his region. And the Dynamic Coasts project, working with local authorities and funding not always simply shoring up coastline, but also understanding that coastlines need to move, and it's about adapting our communities around that. We're also developing a programme for publication in, I think it's 2024, which will respond to CCC's comments and the ever-increasing risk of the need to adapt in Scotland.
I'm very grateful. The Climate Change Committee also called for urgent implementation of a monitoring and evaluation framework, which presumably becomes even more critical given the funding that the Cabinet Secretary's just described, to ensure it's well spent and effective. Now, the Scottish Government committed to progress with such a framework, but as at May 2023, it remains merely in development. Cabinet Secretary, why is this taking so long, particularly given that the Climate Change Committee said that this was an urgent priority?
Thank you. I'm going to hand over to Phil, but it's taking longer because it's an exceptionally difficult thing to monitor. I get this returns to my point about having that numerical emissions reduction, ability to measure emissions reduction in megaton of carbon. It's not as easy to measure something like adaptation. So I think, and Phil will correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the approach that's been taken to date against our adaptation programme is to assess the fulfilment of the policies that we've identified that will contribute to adaptation. What it is harder to do is to have that, you know, that sort of separate monitoring of adaptation as a whole, because it is so many different things in so many different circumstances. But Phil, is there anything we can add to that, please?
I think even just to note that the Climate Change Committee itself recognises that this is new territory, this monitoring evaluation. My understanding is that they're doing work at the moment about how they can enrich the research base and provide advice on what that monitoring evaluation would look like across the board, and that work is still to come. I think the fact, though, that it's difficult to do, and as the Cabinet Secretary rightly notes, we are more about measuring, I guess, the outputs rather than the outcomes. We still need to do something around outcomes, and we recognize that. It is a something that we are intending to put in place over the period of this calendar year, being able to take forward, if you will, a framework that we can continue to improve on and enrich as better ways of doing things, as better advice comes forward. So you're right to call us on it, as indeed it's right to call on just about everyone else, I think, who's trying to wrestle with this difficult problem. And it's one that we fully intend to try to put something in place and get better at doing as the years go by.
Grateful. Convener.
Thank you very much. We've now got a series of questions from Monica. Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I want to start by asking about water scarcity, an issue that's been in the news recently and has been discussed in Parliament with yourself, Cabinet Secretary. Interested to hear, how will water scarcity and flood management be strategically resourced and prioritised over the summer when we are all in recess? And what is the longer term outlook?
Thank you. Thank you, Monica. So if you don't mind, it would be helpful to separate them out, I think, just in my thinking, because they require different things. I often think that sometimes I'm hoping for rain and sometimes I'm hoping the rain will stop. So there's sort of different issues. I think, first of all, with water scarcity, given that we're in that period of the year where that's problematic, I did give I arranged for that round table last week because I understand how much this might be affecting constituents just now. Ultimately, I'm very confident right now that between ourselves and Scottish Government, SEPA, the independent regulator who obviously oversee car licences and abstractions from the environment, and Scottish Water, who are responsible for the public water supply, we have a robust means of monitoring water levels in the country. I think, you know, virtually 24/7, 365 days a year. And also, I think, you know, the sort of political challenge is on abstractions and what happens when the water levels are particularly low and SEPA observe that there could be a risk to the environment, and then we get into the situation where licences for abstraction have to be curtailed. Last year was the first summer that we ever had to do that, and we were very deliberate in the aftermath of that to take time to make sure that we learned all the lessons from it, including one of the things was as early communication as possible about the risk of prolonged periods of dry weather, and also quite a clear idea for farmers, for businesses, for aquaculture, for hydro businesses, about the conditions in which their abstraction licences might be changed. So we've tried to do all of that in terms of your question about suitability of the current framework. And then if you want to move on to flooding, obviously another significant issue. I think that there's two points to make about flooding. One is about funding, and secondly about the sort of future framework and preparedness. On flooding, I mentioned in response to Liam Kerr regarding adaptation that an agreement between us and COSLA, I think it was in 2008, meant that we've provided that £42 million per annum to councils for flooding, and that 80% of that was agreed that would be spent on the strategic projects, and 20% would be distributed among the other 32 councils for others, and that we've made £150 million available this Parliament. But it has to be said that as the risk of flooding increases, that the projects and the need for investment is beginning to outstrip the funding that's available. So we have Scottish Government, COSLA, local authority working group right now looking at funding for flood mitigation schemes across the country. Not just levels of funding, but how it's distributed. And I'm awaiting recommendations on that because I recognise that we've got some very, very expensive schemes in the pipeline. And I want us to collectively all be prepared to do what we can on that. And I've slightly forgotten what my other point about flooding was. It was funding and it was the strategy. Sorry. The other bit of work that we're doing, again, it's about making sure that we are as up to speed as we possibly can on everything that flooding demands of us, is we are setting out a new draft strategy. And it's right at the very beginning of the process, and we're working right across civic society on it. But one of the things in particular that I've asked to be drawn out is that it's a great deal clearer whose responsibility is on the ground, and that there's better joined up working between agencies. So, you know, we all know in our constituencies when something happens, you wonder whether it's, you know, the road network and gullies that have caused the blockage, what SEPA's responsibility is, where the council come in, where we come in. So I'm hoping to make that much clearer.
That's a really helpful update. So as part of that work then, will government be looking at whether there's a need for any sort of change in terms of legislation, the governance arrangements, because it can be quite complex with a number of agencies involved. So at the moment, do you have any sense of whether current legislative and governance arrangements are sufficient to tackle both the current but also the future challenges that you've alluded to in terms of risk profile?
Yeah, no, I think that's the question for the strategy. I'm not envisaging a change to legislation just now. Okay. I expect it will be more a clarification of roles and a reinforcing of, you know, my expectation that in the event, both before and after our flooding event, that all agencies with responsibility are working together and that communities are really put at the heart of it. That's my objective.
Thank you. And you did mention communication at the start, so that's, I'm sure, appreciated. Just coming back to water scarcity, because I'm sure it may be an issue over the summer. Have discussions been taking place between the Scottish Government and the UK Government on the issue of water scarcity?
It's not something that I discuss regularly with the UK Government, no.
And I think it was about 10 days ago I read reports in the media of some restrictions in parts of England around the use of hose pipes and sprinklers and so on in people's gardens. Is that something that could be introduced in Scotland this year?
I suppose these are measures that are always in the toolkit. I don't foresee right now us having to do that. Our public water system is very resilient, thanks in large part to a great deal of investment that Scottish Water have done to provide resilience between areas. We have issued guidance to ask people to be very responsible about the way they use the public water supply during periods of scarcity. The more vulnerable is the private water supply network in Scotland, which has many running dry right now. And that's why we've made the bottled water scheme available very early. But that's a bit of a way of dealing with it in the here and now. We've also got a longer piece of work ongoing, trying to see what would be required to connect those who remain on the private supply into the public network.
Thank you. Okay, I have a few more questions, Convener. Moving more to environmental protection and biodiversity. So regarding progress with the Scottish Environment Strategy, can you let us know what work is being undertaken to identify additional indicators? And what is your view on how the strategy and its monitoring framework can be used to have a tangible impact in the context of multiple other strategies?
Thank you. This is demonstrating the vastness of the portfolio now. So the biodiversity strategy, I think, is a really important piece of work. I think that it both collates in one space all of the important interventions that the government's making across the piece, which are many, and it also should be the platform from which we, you know, strive for greater progress. Officials have been undertaking quite a bit of work on this, and I think it's Dave's team. One of the things that has been done recently is we have commissioned research against, I think, two or three of the outcomes that we had published along with the vision for the strategy, and that work is ongoing. I think that we had done economy and one other, and we were looking to commission research on the social outcome, but that work is ongoing.
Thank you. The panel will know that the Scottish Environment Strategy is a requirement of Section 47 of the Continuity Act, and that Act enables ministers to keep pace with EU law, and its design assures that Scottish environment law and standard can keep pace with EU developments. To that end, I'm wondering, what actions are ministers and officials taking to ensure that environment law keeps pace with EU standards, including the work that is progressing on ecocide law?
Thank you for the question. So we scan the horizon for EU developments in the environment, and what we were just talking about with water is a key example of that, with the new water directive coming through and us doing what we can to comply with that. Ecocide is another issue, and I know it's one that you're very close to. I have sought advice on it, and just now my view is that in taking forward the right to a healthy environment via the Human Rights Bill, we should be able to achieve a great deal of what development of ecocide might, but I absolutely don't turn my mind away from something domestically on ecocide, but it's for now I feel that some of its objectives are being taken forward in the right to a healthy environment, which I've got to say is being led by the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice.
Yes, interesting. I'm sure that's a conversation we'll continue in the months ahead. Thank you for that. Also, we had a letter from the Minister in December stating that the process for developing a biodiversity delivery plan will involve identifying priority actions and identifying delivery partners, mechanisms for delivery, and the targets and indicators needed to successfully deliver those actions. I wonder if you can update on how you are determining priority actions and how you're engaging with stakeholders and securing buy-in across multiple sectors.
Yes, I can do. So this, I assume the letter from the Minister was from Ms Slater, because she's leading on the biodiversity strategy and the overlap with the Natural Environment Bill. And she will go out to consultation this summer. And I understand that the consultation is in two parts. One will be on the draft of the biodiversity strategy and the delivery plan that you mentioned. Mm-hmm. And then the other part, I think, is on some of the early proposals for the Natural Environment Bill and our intention to legislate for nature recovery targets. So she will go out to consultation on that in the summer, I understand, and that will be the first step to gathering that public view that you've rightly asked about.
It's helpful to get these timescales. And then just my final question, convener, is so we've got the biodiversity delivery plan, the investment plan and proposals for a natural environment bill. How will government ensure or take best efforts to ensure that these plans are integrated, and what resources will be allocated to them that is commensurate with the scale of the nature emergency?
So on resources, first of all, we will attribute resources in a budgetary manner in the normal way once the consultation is done, once we understand how the public feel about what we're proposing, and once those proposals are more concrete, I will consider it as part of the portfolio budget. But more widely, actually, there is a question within all of this about public sector funding versus private funding. And I think that, you know, the government's view is very much that two things: the public sector can't pay for the restoration of nature alone, particularly when you set that alongside everything else that needs to be done in the climate and nature emergencies. And there is scope to leverage in responsible private finance. And I think we see that as being part of the development of the delivery plan for the biodiversity strategy. However, I should be very clear that that is responsible private finance. That is not, you know, greenwashing. It must have integrity. And so we're working on all of that through the interim principles of responsible investment in natural capital, which I always wish had a shorter name. In terms of linking these up, so I mentioned that Ms. Slater is leading on this on a daily basis, but her, Marie Goujon and myself, we have regular trilaterals on natural capital and the natural environment to make sure that from both Marie and I's perspective, you know, it's reconciling between our portfolios. We also have the Cabinet Subcommittee on the Climate Emergency, which the Nature Emergency is part of as well, and I would expect Ms. Slater will want to present to that Cabinet Subcommittee at some point on this as well. So there's a number of ways that we can make sure that these policies and these strategies are linking up across government.
Thank you. Many more topics to get through, so back to you, Convener.
Okay, just before we leave the environment, if you explain, Cabinet Secretary, the importance of biodiversity and the aim to reach net zero. Trees, which we grow a few on the farm, but purely for non-commercial purposes, but commercially and across Scotland, we had a target of 15,000 hectares to be planted last year. We achieved 8,000 hectares. That's only 53% of the total. We are gradually dropping behind year on year since 2016 from government targets. Does that worry you?
Of course. The extent to which we're not meeting our targets across government is a concern for me wherever it occurs. However, I have to say, in the case of forestry, which is not in my portfolio anymore, I should flag up, so I'm freewheeling here in Ms. Goujon's portfolio, which I ought not to do, but having had that role previously, in forestry, I have great confidence in that industry. It's exceptionally well established. It brings £1 billion into the economy. It employs 25,000 people. It is doing exceptionally well in Scotland, and people around the world often ask us, how do we mirror what your forestry industry have done? But we are stretching them. We are pushing them with targets that are really stretching, and headwinds such as Brexit and Storm Arwen and others have created difficulties in recent years. So too has a contraction in the availability of labour following EU exit. So yes, I want us to meet annual targets on tree planting because it's essential to net zero. But I have great confidence in the forestry industry in Scotland that they will face the headwinds and come through them and reach the very stretching targets.
We did see an agreement signed between Lorna Slater and private investment to increase forestry. We were trying to find out exactly what that would involve and what levels of funding were going to be generated and how the private sector were going to benefit from it, because although they're altruistic, I'm sure, in wanting to see more trees, there must be some benefit. I'm not sure we ever got to the bottom of that. Do you fully understand it, Cabinet Secretary?
So I don't know what agreement you're talking about. If you can give me more information, I'd be glad to talk about it.
OK, I'm wondering if David knows about it.
Are you referring to the agreement that Nature Scott made with... I can't remember the name of the financial institutions... But
I am indeed, David, the one that the Cabinet Secretary's colleague, Lorna Slater, signed.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, I can...
We should clarify, Convener, forestry is not in this portfolio.
I know, but it's, forestry is going to play a part in biodiversity and reaching our net zero targets.
Absolutely.
I feel, and I thought David's role was Director of Environment and Forestry in Scottish Government. I felt he might be able to answer the question.
Well, David, you can see what you want on that, but I think we should stick to the remit of the portfolio, just as we wouldn't delve into agricultural policy or energy policy in this depth.
David, do you want to comment on it?
I don't think it's appropriate for me to comment on the arrangements that Nature Scott have entered into at this committee.
I think I would add, though, that, and I'm again reaching back to when I was in the environment portfolio, that if it's a question of tree planting funded in, by the private sector and what they get from that, of course we need the Woodland Carbon Code, just as we need the Peatland Carbon Code, to have integrity, to ensure that any support is additional and doesn't amount to greenwashing. And recent changes in the Woodland Carbon Code brought me great comfort in that regard, because what they said was that if, and I'm sort of explaining it crudely, but if a scheme was to be commercially viable on its own, then carbon credits wouldn't be available to it. So yes, the Woodland Carbon Code is catching up with the speed of the land market and the natural capital market in Scotland, and it is using these mechanisms to make sure that any private investment and carbon credits that come from it are not amounting to greenwashing in Scotland.
Just before we leave this, then, could you just confirm that Nature Scott falls within your portfolio or Marie Goujon's portfolio?
It'd be Marie Goujon's, I understand.
Nature Scott is controlled entirely by her.
Miss Slater is the portfolio lead, and I understand she works to Miss Goujon on that. Nature Scott does not fall within my remit.
It's very confusing for us all, I'm sure. Mark, you have some questions.
Yes. So if I can move on to the retained EU law bill. And in particular, you know, we're aware of the timescale now, the concerns that the Scottish Government has over Schedule 1 and the list of retained EU law that's proposed to be revoked. Could I get your comments, please, on the laws that are within Schedule 1 and what your overall impression is of the bill?
Okay, so first of all, I welcome the change in the approach with the retained EU law bill. I think the initial formulation of it is one of the most foolish, idiotic approaches to developing law for a country that I have perhaps ever witnessed. And I think many people who've been doing this for a great deal longer than I have would have ever witnessed. It was utterly worthy of ridicule. So I am very pleased that a U-turn has been performed on that, and that we now have a case where, you know, you have to explicitly flag something up if it is to be lost rather than just by omission. So for my part, I've been concerned to see that air quality laws are contained within Schedule 1. The government as a whole has been pressing the UK government on matters that have been included in Schedule 1. My view is very much that it should be removed. It should not be there. I don't understand the justification for it being there. I don't understand what UK government intend to do in absence of it, and I think it's very concerning. So we have explicitly asked at Director General level that it be removed. That has been declined, and it's now coming to me, and I will communicate with my UK government counterparts about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's somewhat of a relief that we're looking at only 9 pieces of legislation in Schedule 1 rather than potentially 4,000. I think that would have given this committee quite a job to do, as well as the government. But can I just ask a bit more then about the National Air Pollution Control Programme specifically, and the proposed revocation of that entire legal framework as is currently proposed by the UK government. What are the particular concerns that Scottish Government would have about losing that air quality framework?
Well, the first concern is that I don't know what would replace it. So let's assume that there is no plan. The most concerning thing then is about monitoring and about, you know, it's that I'm not intimately familiar with the legislation itself, but it's about monitoring and transparency of monitoring, and to lose that overarching piece of work is, of course, of great concern. And that is why we have been pushing for it to be removed.
Mm-hmm. And presumably, Scottish Government's in contact with Environmental Standards Scotland as well. We've received a letter from ESS, particularly detailing concerns about what the loss of national plans might involve, the removal of the public duty.
Yes, absolutely, and we share Environmental Standards Scotland's concerns on it all. I think they put it better than I could.
Okay. So, what is the route then that Scottish Government ministers have to remove that air quality legislation from Schedule 1? Because my understanding is that effectively it's a shared area of policy. So, you know, this is shared between UK Government, Scottish Government. So, what's the mechanism for doing that? Does this now go into a common framework conversation? I mean, the clock's ticking, as I understand it. I mean, I think we've got until 31st of October at the very latest. And then we've obviously got summer recesses as well. Mm-hmm. So if this is just to fall over the cliff, what does that conversation look like?
Yeah, so I should clarify that in terms of the oversight of the retained EU law bill and the relations between us and UK government on that, my colleague Angus Robertson leads on the government's approach. So for my part, it was important to me to understand, well, first of all, we were undertaking this enormous piece of work to try and find everything that hadn't been listed. Now I know what is potentially under threat in my area, and it's about me, you know, as I said, senior civil servants, and then myself in the case of a refusal, making the case for why that shouldn't be there. But in terms of your question about the Scottish Government's response to rule at large, I don't lead on that. That's for Angus Robertson.
Hmm. But specifically in terms of air quality, mm-hmm. you said that has there been a discussion around the loss of the National Air Quality Plan, and UK Government's position is that it's in the schedule and it's going?
The UK Government's position is that they've declined when we raised with them at Director General level to remove it. They declined that request. And as far as we understand, there's no plan to replace it on their part. And therefore, it's now for me to escalate that to my ministerial UK government counterparts and to make the case very clearly as to why we believe it should be removed. I don't think, and again, I'm reluctant to stray into this because it is something that Angus Robertson is leading on. But as far as I'm aware, you mentioned, you know, it's a joint piece of work. I don't know of tools that we have in order to change what UK government propose or otherwise in the schedule. Mm. So I don't think that there is a mechanism that we could use as Scottish ministers to do that.
Okay, it would just go.
Sorry?
It would just go.
Well, that's the case that I'll try and build against.
Mm. Okay. All right, thanks.
Thanks, Mark. Now, Cabinet Secretary, I've got a couple of questions on transport, if I may. The committee, in its pre-budget scrutiny session last year, looked at EV charging and the rollout of EV charging. Mm-hmm. And I believe that you indicated when you wrote to us there was going to be quite a lot of public investment, I think £30 million on top of the government's investment. And so far this year, I think when you updated the committee, we'd spent £7.25 million of the funding had been allocated, but no new charge points installations have been directly supported by the fund to date. Installations are expected to begin in early 2024. Do you think we're dropping behind on EV charging points? Do you think the fact if we had more EVs would be on the road because people had confidence they could top them up when they need to?
So I think we always need more. And that's why I think one of the first things that the Minister for Transport did was launch our vision for the public charging network. Look, to date we have done very well. You will have heard us quote ad nauseum that we have the most per head of population public charging points outside of London. But we're not resting on our laurels, and that's why we're, as you've pointed out, making more public funding available to continue the spread. Because I understand, of course, people will have confidence to buy an electric vehicle if they have confidence that they're going to be able to charge it. I think we've done really well to date, but we're keeping to push on. And I think our ambition is to double where we are today.
I'm not sure that that view is the one shared out in more rural areas. I mean, if you look at London, for example, you can see virtually a charging point almost on every lamppost with the ability to do it. And if you go to Milton Keynes, I seem to remember they have a strategy. If you are more than a certain distance from a charging point, you can ask for a charging point to be installed in a lamppost to enable you to charge your vehicles. Do you see the government, Scottish Government promoting it to that level? Or do you think that's unreasonable?
Well, I think you make a good point about the difference in requirements between urban and rural Scotland. It's ever thus with transport, and we have to understand the requirements and respond to them. So they are going to be different, as between Glasgow and London, as they are with rural Scotland. But I think, and Alison, please, you might want to come in on this, but some of that funding, which, as you rightly point out, is currently being used as scoping and planning and development with installations to be expected to begin from 24, I think probably is about understanding the needs of the various different areas and the local authorities being very well placed to speak to that.
Don't me to
yeah, please, Alison, if you don't mind. Thank you.
So just to add to what the Cabinet Secretary said, so I think that we're what I would describe as a pivot point with our EV charging and the approach that we've taken to support where Scotland is in terms of the level of provision. There is absolutely no doubt that we need more. The Climate Change Committee was very clear on what it sees as the number of charging stations that are needed to support the level of ambition that we've got. We don't feel that that is something that government can do on its own. So we need to find a way in which to drive quite a significant private sector investment. You drew out the kind of the differences between London and some of our rural areas. I think if you look at the way in which private sector investment tends to go, there will become clear areas where there will be more of a need for public sector involvement, funding, support than there will in other areas. So what we're trying to do at the moment with the EV vision, the charging vision that was launched last week, is just to get us to that kind of transition point where we're able to encourage private sector investment but recognise where public sector investment is best made. How do we do that? We do that using our local and regional transport authorities, because those are the areas, those are the organisations and people that know and understand our communities best, and that's the work that's ongoing at the moment.
So is the view we need many more? I mean, I could give you the example of the charging point at Achnacheen, which was sat there for 2 years looking very pretty, but it didn't work because it wasn't connected to anything. So, I mean, rural areas are feeling a bit left out. So, do you think we need more? And what more are you going to do if we need this move to EVs?
So, the Climate Change Committee said that we need 30,000 EV charging points by 2030. That's quite a significant increase on where we are at the moment. Our public commitment is to get to 6,000 by 2026. That was set out in the First Minister's policy prospectus, and that's the work that we're trying to drive the change with the EV framework. I can't comment particularly on the Achnacheen particular charging station. However, what I would say is that everywhere I go, if there's a charging station that is not in action, then I am held personally accountable for it. And that just points to the complexities of the market that we've got. And
you don't need to worry, it's now being connected, but it was an awfully long time getting there. But the point is 30 million put aside, we've spent 7 million. There's quite a drop there. There's a mismatch if we need so many more.
So I wouldn't say that it's a drop. I would say that it's a continued challenge, and we're trying to change the mechanisms in order to bring in much more public sector investment.
It comes to that question, I think, about the public sector's role in giving confidence to the market. You know, we make an intervention, we did so early, we were successful in that, and it's only right that we should then assess whether public funding should continue at the same level or whether the market is developing sufficiently to allow it to develop. And I think Alison's point about and it relates to yours, that there will be areas where the market might not drive the change that's required. And then, of course, that's where public funding can come back in. But I think, yes, we need more. I think we've done very well today. And it's worth pointing out that the current charging network is already owned with a mixture of private and public.
OK, I seem to have sparked an outbreak of questions on EV charging points. So I'm going to go to Bob, and then I'm going to Monica if these are on EVs, and then to Mark on EVs. Or if it's transports as a whole, Mark, I'll ask my next question after those two and then come to you. So, Bob.
Convener, it is on EVs. It's not about ACT machine, I have to say. I can tell. But it isn't EV charging, but not charging points, but rather the charging regimes across each local authority and the length of stay requirements at different bays within each local authority. It's certainly my experience in Glasgow, particularly with the taxi trade, where they've invested in EV vehicles, that there is EV tourism taking place where vehicles go long distances to get cheaper tariffs, or they can't fully charge their cars because of restrictions about a three-hour limit, and it causes a lot of issues. And it's also counterintuitive that we're getting EV vehicles to travel longer distances to get better tariff rates. So is that something that's on the radar of government, and can we look to see an alignment and a reasonable charging regime implemented across Scotland, urban and rural, convener?
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Mr. Dorris. I will answer a couple of those points, and then I might come to Alison. So I think, first of all, the point that I was making to the convener about the fact that the network itself is currently owned in some public, some private, you know, in a series of different ways. So there's a limit to, you know, our oversight of it, or, you know, a local authority oversight of it. On the point about charging, I was quite supportive of local authorities. I wasn't in post at time, but I felt like it was the right thing to do, that local authorities should begin to charge. You know, whilst folks are paying a great deal of money for fuel, for petrol and diesel, I thought it was right that we should be able to recoup some revenue from electric charging. Now, I think there is a question about the extent to which local authorities have taken that up, and there will be some who are and some who aren't, and the levels of charging. So it comes down to a question of the local authority's right to decide, I suppose, on the existence of charging to start with, and then the level of it. But certainly if it's causing concern, particularly amongst those who make their living and require to charge their cars, I think it's something that we should look at.
So I don't have much to add, apart from to confirm, yes, it's on our radar. We've got a myriad of different charging structures that exist across the country that drive certain behaviours, just as you've outlined. If you look at the similarities between, dare I say it, the ICE, the petrol and diesel filling stations, and the way in which that market has evolved and matured, and think that that's probably where we will need to get to with the EV charging regime. But in order to do that while we're still encouraging people to uptake the vehicles, there are a number of steps that we'll need to take along the way, and it's complex. Okay, and it's on our radar.
Ms. Irvin, that's really helpful. Convener, I've already sought a meeting with the relevant political leads at Glasgow City Council about the impact on the taxi sector in Glasgow, but obviously a much wider issue. Mr. Irvin, I really welcome a meeting separate from this committee, of course, with Transport Scotland, with some of the wider issues that perhaps go unnoticed. So, for example, convener, it actually takes much more expensive to charge an EV vehicle in the winter. They have to work harder, and it's more costly. So I don't think the tariffs are reflective of the overall cost, certainly if you make your living from driving a car that is environmentally friendly as a car can be. So I would certainly welcome a meeting out with this forum to discuss that further, and not about Glasgow, but a more kind of national strategy would be very helpful.
Okay, subject to the Cabinet Secretary agreeing with that, I'm happy
of course,
to do that.
Yes.
Okay, and I think it's quite interesting. I think Highland Council a couple of weeks ago stopped their rates because they were undercutting everyone else, giving cheaper electricity. Monica, you wanted to come in on that.
Yeah, just briefly. So it's not so much about the number of chargers, but it's about you know, whether we have enough rapid or ultra-rapid chargers. I think that's the latest terminology. So the vision document may cover this. Apologies, I haven't read it yet, but glad that Ms Hislop is involved. As well as the rollout of more chargers, what work has been done to upgrade existing chargers and to obviously use best technology and get more rapid chargers across the country?
So I think it's an absolutely it's a key point. It's one of the many complexities. So it's availability of the charge network and the speed with which you're able to charge and the price that it costs you. And again, all of those variables that I've mentioned with Mr. Doris apply here, in the case that it's owned by different companies, set by different local authorities in some cases. But obviously, our aim would be to have the rapid ultra chargers rolled out to the greatest extent possible, because they're the quickest and they're the most convenient. And I'm increasingly seeing them. And of course, they're a mark of how technology has developed quite quickly over the course of the period when people's expectation of charging an electric car has grown. So it's a mixed picture with the types of technology, their rollout, and the costs of them. But of course, ultra and fast chargers are the optimum of what we would all want to see.
Thank you.
Mark, I'm going to come to you afterwards if it's a general point. So my next question is not going to surprise the Cabinet Secretary. It surprised me no one else wanted to answer it, so ask it. So it is on the A9, and when are you going to lay out the programme for dualling the A9 that has been promised?
I will lay that out as soon as I possibly can, and with a backdrop of autumn this year.
Okay.
A backstop.
So autumn, by the end of autumn, and before the start of winter, we will have the dualling programme for the whole of the A9 from Perth to Inverness.
It's my intention, with a backstop of autumn this year, to set out next steps on the dualling of the programme. And I should say that my principal objective here is the quickest, most successful procurement that I can possibly manage, ensuring value for money. And all of those strands are currently occupying a lot of time across the transport team.
Cabinet Secretary, the one word, or two words, or one sentence, sorry, not two words, one sentence, it is my intention. Are we or are we not going to have the programme with dates on when the A9 will be dualled from Perth to Inverness by the end of autumn?
I'm not going to preempt what I will tell Parliament, because there's still decisions to be made. There's still a great deal of work ongoing. But I will set out with a backstop of autumn this year the next steps on the dualling programme.
I'm not sure I'm any more comfortable on that. Liam, do you want to come back on, see if you can go further?
I'm very grateful. The question begged, of course, if asking about the A9, is because a similar promise was made about the A96. So the question begged is, when will the A96 be dualled, Cabinet Secretary?
So we are... work is ongoing all the time, and I'll maybe ask Alison to give a technical update on it, on the Inverness to Nairn, the bypass. Separately, we're undertaking the corridor review, and that work is ongoing, and I don't have a date for when that will be completed.
But the A96 will be fully dualled between Aberdeen and Inverness?
Yes, that is still our plan.
But you have no idea when?
Well, we're undertaking a review as we set out in our
programme
for government.
But you have no idea when, Cabinet Secretary?
It's not a case of not having an idea. It's a case of being a responsible government and minister looking at all of the matters that we have to consider against our commitment to review the corridor as a whole.
Convener.
And just before I pass over to Mark for the next question, running along the edge of the A9 is a very important railway line for the Highlands. A lot of talk has been made of decarbonising transport, and that would require more trains to go up and down that route. So what are the plans for putting double tracks up there in significant proportion to allow more trains to run on that route, and maybe increase the use of it by decreasing the travel time in the future rather than increasing it, which is what's happened in the last 10 years.
Convener, I am not able to speak to that particular line today. I'm more than happy to go away and get more information for that. And, you know, if my colleague Alison wants to add anything to it, we can, but on specific rail projects like that. But can I, sorry, I should just say in response to Mr. Kerr that so we are taking forward the work. Part of that was a climate compatibility test. We've got outcomes of work that we have done that are due to be available this summer, and then they will go for final consultation. So it's, if it's helpful in any way, there'll be developments this summer.
Sorry, I'm going to let Liam, you asked a question, you got a response, you just come back in.
Yes, I'm grateful for the clarification, Cabinet Secretary. So, but then the question begged is, could the climate compatibility test that you've just talked about then prevent the full duelling of the A96 from Inverness to Aberdeen, given if its conclusions are this is not climate compatible?
I suppose all of our considerations in respect of the project could have a bearing on it, but I will set out the more details of that this summer for a final consultation.
Thank you very much. And Cabinet Secretary, any information you could provide on the railways and the link between Perth and Inverness would be much appreciated.
Could add a spot if that would be helpful, we can come back to you.
We are quite close to time.
Okay.
Very happy to take a written answer.
Okay,
if that helps you, Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, thank you.
And maybe give you a chance to find a bit more information on it. So, Mark, next question from you.
I think it would be useful to get a written response on the corridor review of the A96, because as I understand it, there are multiple options there, including the completion of a number of bypasses as well. But I wanted to take to the skies, Cabinet Secretary, and ask you about the aviation strategy. So how will the aviation strategy dovetail with the climate change plan? Because I think the aviation strategy was due earlier this year. We've seen the post-COVID bounce back in aviation. I'm sure the aviation sector would like a buy, would like to, you know, see increased number of flights, increased people using flights. So how do we square that?
I'm going to ask Alison to come in with some of the details on that, if she doesn't mind. I suppose just on the generality, there is likely to be a rebound in aviation as people travelled post-pandemic. I'm very much of the view that we have to tackle aviation emissions, of course we do. We are an island nation, however, and I think that we don't want to cut ourselves off from travel, economic, cultural exchange, etc., from the rest of the world. And so there are a number of options open to us, including development of sustainable aviation fuels and others. But on the strategy, I might hand over to Alison.
Okay, so Cabinet Secretary, actually you've covered all the kind of the main points, but on the aviation strategy itself, I'm aware that there was that commitment to publish one. We're doing a lot of work on that, and it's a case of bringing ministers up to speed with what the strategy is kind of going to set out, so that ministers can get comfortable with that before we publish it. So work is ongoing.
So does that mean then that emissions from aviation are going to drop, just as they're going to have to drop on the A9, the A96,
so I think
in
the
farming and every other sector of our economy, or is aviation going to grow?
So I think as we started at the outset of this committee session, it's really obvious that action needs to be taken in every sector. And what we are having to do in every sector, including aviation, is balance that kind of economic connectivity piece that we want versus the very significant, very serious climate emissions challenge that we have here.
Okay.
And that is a very fine line to walk, and that is the path that we're taking.
Okay. So it could be then that other sectors or other parts of the transport sector might have to have steeper reductions in emissions in order to deliver the benefits of aviation.
So again, you've got that kind of balance between where the technology is at, what the opportunity is, how the cost sits with that.
And the powers as well.
And the role of the private sector and all of that.
So. And I think on that point, thank you, Alison, on the point about powers, Phil was just mentioning to me about UK government work on this.
Aviation is in a similar territory to what you might think of the wider industry envelope, which is there's a huge amount we can do ourselves within Scotland, but the real bulk of it, the powers of it, lie with the UK government. And the UK government has set out that its vehicle for reducing, for tackling aviation in a climate change perspective is going to be tied up with the Jet Zero strategy. So there's an element where there's much we can do ourselves, and as the Cabinet Secretary and as my colleague Alison has pointed out, there's work underway, there's a lot of different considerations that need to be brought into bear in that. But we also have to recognise that we are kind of looking for the UK government to take the lead and to show its hand, if you will, on some of the key measures going forward as part of that. So it's an important context.
Okay.
Thanks very much. Mark Ash, I think you have got the next question.
Thank you, Convener. The Environment Committee did a report, it's a while ago now actually, on the implementation of the regional marine planning. The Scottish Government had undertaken to provide a response to that, but we've still not received it. Would you be able to give us an update on the timescale for that?
Yes, I acknowledge the length of time that has passed between the publication of it. We are working on our final response, and I am hoping that that will be published in due course.
Okay, thank you. And then moving on to the highly protected marine areas policy. So the Cabinet Secretary and I have exchanged letters on this topic. The Scottish Government is saying that it's going to be evidence-driven, evidence-led, but the Lamlash Bay, if we think of that as a trial, it would seem to me and to others that that is quite a small area, and clearly there isn't really sufficient data coming out of there. There's very little data there at all. Would a larger trial area or even a number of trial areas ahead of this policy coming into implementation not be prudent in order to collect more data that the government could then use to base its policy decisions on?
Thank you for the question. And I suppose I would just say from the outset that in the context of something like the HPMAs, I don't discount any suggestions or views on what might have or might work in the future. Just firstly, on you know, there is evidence that enhanced marine protection is needed, not least us and the UK emitting, I think, 11 out of 15 of the targets for good environmental status. There's evidence that it works. You mentioned Lamlash Bay, although I appreciate that's on a smaller scale, but there is evidence in California, New Zealand, etc., that completely protected areas work for species abundance, for ecosystem recovery, for spillover, for a whole series of things. On the point about a trial area, of course the UK government has taken that approach. I have two main concerns about it. One is that the changes that we see in marine protected areas, they happen over a long period of time. So I would be concerned that if we rested on a trial area, we would be a great deal of time waiting to see what the impact would be before we could make the progress that science tells us is actually needed now. The other reason that I don't think it's the right thing to pursue is that it's top-down. So it would require, or it would have required if we'd done it like this from the beginning, me to say that site, and that site have been selected by government to become a highly protected marine area. And it wouldn't have had the community engagement and the socio-economic assessment that I wanted to run through the whole process. But I appreciate that on the question of how you do these things, it's balanced. That's why we didn't pursue a pilot.
Okay. So there obviously has been a high degree of criticism of the plans that the government is setting out. I know this, the government said they met 20 stakeholder group representatives of the marine industries and users as well. But that was prior to the consultation. And that obviously includes now some of those who are now the most critical of the proposal. So I wonder if the government can update on what schedule they have for kind of maybe meeting with people now the proposals are a little bit clearer. And also, how does the government intend to work with stakeholders and local communities? I mean, I'm noting that it feels like it's quite a confrontational situation that we've got ourselves into now. Certainly with local communities. So how does the government intend to move forward from that and get into a situation where they're working with communities is maybe a better way to look at it, in a way that the communities themselves would consider to be meaningful.
Yes, and I think that that last point is the critical point, because the way that the approach had been taken to consult very deeply and right at the very beginning of the process, I believed, my team believed, was the right way to do it in order to be at the drawing board and to bring people to the drawing board with us. However, I absolutely accept that for many people, particularly those who felt they would be impacted by it, they didn't feel that they had that was the right approach for them. So you mentioned the meetings. We had around 20 prior. We also held around 20 during the consultation period to make sure that people could be taken through it and could take part in it, because that was really important to me. Since then, myself and Marie Goujon, we've been meeting with stakeholders on it since it closed. I think she met with stakeholders in Shetland. I did so in Troon. I've had a meeting with Fisher people in Troon and with Coast in Arran. I've met with the Western Isles Council and with SIF. And I have plans over the summer to visit the Uists and Orkney, I hope, although they are not completely finalised yet. I think it's confirmed, convener. I don't want to preempt any decisions of the Bureau, but I'm due to give a statement this week on next steps on highly protected marine areas. So with that being the case, I shouldn't want to preempt any of that. But I'll be reflecting a little bit on some of the early consultation responses and giving my view of where we go from here, exactly on the point you mentioned, meaningful engagement.
OK, just one very final short question, if the convener allows.
I'm not sure I have the option, but I'll go for it.
Have the Scottish Government taken into account the criticism of the selection criteria?
So I mentioned I'm going to reflect on the early responses to the consultation. The much more in-depth analysis of what people told us is still developing. We invited commentary on site selection criteria, on what would be protected, the whole spectrum, what would constitute an HPMA. So I have to continue looking through all of that. And of course, I'll reflect on every aspect of it.
Thank you, convener.
OK, we have some questions next from Liam and then from Bob. And just to remind members, we are quite short on time, but I don't want to curtail you, Liam.
Thank you, convener. Cabinet Secretary, you talked about the vastness of the portfolio right at the start, but many, particularly in the North East, were pretty stunned that energy was removed from net zero and put elsewhere. Now, meanwhile, of course, Just Transition is in your brief, but by virtue of that decoupling earlier, has been decoupled from energy. Do you have any reflection on whether those were the correct choices?
I think they were, and I think that's for one key reason. Just Transition is absolutely oil and gas, but it is also broader than oil and gas. So the climate change brief is a very cross-cutting, cross-government role. And so too is Just Transition, because for every decision that we make in the climate change space, which, as I've narrated today, is an enormous change agenda, it is very important, I think, that the Just Transition principles sit side by side with that and follow the climate change progress throughout government and everything that we're doing more broadly. So, I think it is the right thing to do. Just Transition isn't just oil and gas. It's a huge part of it, but it's also agriculture, it's also marine, it's also transport, it's everything that is encompassed within the climate change brief.
Well, indeed so, but your government published the Just Transition Plan for Energy in January 23 and committed to another three Just Transition plans to be published ahead of the climate change plan update, which I understand will be November 2023. Recent correspondence seems to suggest that they won't be published until 2024. So will these Just Transition plans be published prior to the climate change plan as the government committed to?
It's my intention that they are, yes. Phil's just saying he can perhaps come in on this. It's my intention that they are. So the statutory requirement regarding the plan is for it to be laid later than we are proposing that it does so. So our Bute House agreement is that we publish it in November, the first draft. And my intention is that the Just Transition papers should also go alongside that because of that statutory commitment within the Climate Act to the government has to demonstrate that it's taken into account Just Transition principles. So for, in my view, the publication of those is the way that we will demonstrate how we've done that, and I think it's right that they should coincide. But I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that.
Can I come in? I'm sure there is stuff, but you answered the question.
Okay.
I'm just conscious of time.
Yep.
Sticking with the Just Transition plan for energy specifically, the consultation recently closed on that. What is the timeline for revising that in light of that consultation? And will there be a further consultation or whatever comes out from that? Will that be the final version?
Currently, I'm not expecting a further full consultation. A great deal of work is currently ongoing, responding to what was a number of comments. Most of those, I should say, pertain to the energy aspects of the report rather than the Just Transition aspects of the report. So whilst Neil Gray and I are working jointly on that, it's principally the energy teams who are engaged with responding to what were principally energy comments.
And then finally, on the Just Transition Fund specifically, so we know that £25 million was released and has been applied into. The next £25 million is being made available through the Scottish National Investment Bank. Why did the process change, and is that going to be the process going forward involving the SNIB for the rest of the funds?
So the future approaches to the distribution of the £500 million fund are subject to budgetary choices in the future. And there's no saying that we won't return to the way that it was before, and there's no saying that the next one will be via the Scottish National Investment Bank. That's the way that we've chosen to distribute the first and the second pot, and I'll make my decision as to the third suite of funding when I get to it.
Does the fact that it's being run through the SNIB change the thresholds for minimum applications, and is there any impact on the geographical spread of the Just Transition Fund?
I'm really sorry, Mr Kerr, I missed the start of your question.
Of course. So the fact that it's being run through the Scottish National Investment Bank this time, does that change the thresholds, because the Scottish National Investment Bank usually has a threshold for applications in. So does the fact that the process has changed change those thresholds for applicants, and does it change anything about where the Just Transition Fund's funds geographically should be put?
It does not change the geography, and I don't expect that it changes the thresholds, but I will check the latter point and come back to you.
Very grateful.
It's going to be interesting in the future as this committee remains with energy and Just Transition remains with the Economy Committee, but I'm sure there'll be some blurring of the lines as they both come within your portfolio.
Yes.
Or some of it comes within your portfolio. Bob, I think you've got the final questions.
Yeah, and I'll restrict myself just to the ones you were hoping to get some comments on the record. Convener, so as the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights, it's one of your support ministers, one of your supporting ministers, could you give the committee an update on when the Scottish Government plans to consult on the proposals of the Heat in Buildings Bill are likely to emerge?
So we are working on the final details of what we're going to be consulting on right now, and we are moving to start that process as soon as we can, but we're in quite a delicate period of the development, so I wouldn't want to preempt exactly, but it's a major part of our climate change plan draft, which will be laid in November, so hopefully that gives you an idea of timescales.
Okay, so later this year?
Yes.
Okay. Keen to ask more, but I won't restrict myself because of time. Can you update the committee on the Heat and Energy Efficiency Scotland agency, which is being developed? I think it's virtual at the moment, but it's not fully fledged as yet. So where is it in relation to its development?
I'm trying to retrieve from my mind the last update that I got on this. So we have appointed Professor Lorne Creer, who is a very well respected lawyer, to advise on the board's remit and its setting up of it, etc. And I'll hopefully receive an update on that shortly.
Okay. Can I just ask a very brief
question? Yes. Can I just say on that, I I understand the breadth of the portfolio. It would be helpful to have a written, a bit more detail in a written response posed to the committee when you've had a chance to reflect on that. Sorry, Bob.
Yeah. I'll forego my supplementary question if we're going to get a written update in relation to that. I know time is tight.
If you want to put it on the record, I can make sure the written update responds to
it. No, I was just going to ask. I mean, I'm passing through this committee, Cabinet Secretary, I should say, and I was curious to know whether the new agency, what extent it will be consumer facing, because I was looking at some of the things it will be trying to pull together various strands on. So, for example, area based schemes for Warm Home Scotland, the whole house approach in relation to some of that as well, the Heat Networks Fund, the Social Housing Zero Heat Fund, the Green Public Sector Heat Fund, and that's just some of them I looked at ahead of this morning's committee. And I'm just wondering, at what point will that be sector facing? Will it be joining the dots of government? And how will it be consumer or public facing?
I think you identify a really important point, and I think a lot of that is exactly what the strategic board will look at. I expect that there will be an extent to which is working with local government and also have that public facing, public awareness raising role. But a great deal of that is still under development, and I'll update you in writing on it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, just on that, could you just clarify the heat and energy efficiency, the heat in buildings bill? I mean, just my calculations, if Highland Council were to update their housing stock to make it all EPCC, the estimated cost is £250 million. Will that heat in buildings bill have some detailed financial workings on how we're going to achieve the requirements of the bill?
Well, absolutely. So I mentioned in response to Mr. Dorris about how all of those aspects of what is quite an enormous piece of work are currently being looked at. So it's the cost, it's supply chain, it's the skills involved in the development of it, it's the impact on the housing market. Huge amount of work happening on all of that just now. And of course, we're moving to consultation, so that will be the point at which we'll seek views on what's there and anything that this committee or anyone else thinks ought to be there.
Thank you very much. And that comes to... Liam, you're frowning. Have I missed a question you wanted to ask?
Just if I may, Convener, very,
as long
very
as it's one
on
and it's
that
brief.
Point, on that
one
point.
One and brief, Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, when the Heat in Building Strategy came out, which was around 2 years ago, I think, it quantified the cost of decarbonising heat in buildings at £33 billion. Now, 2 years on, and obviously a very changed situation, what's that cost now?
We have two sets of costs, one out to 2030, another out to 2045, and the recent figures that I've seen are still in the same remit that you've set out there.
Thank you. Thank you. Brief question and a brief answer. Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, that brings us to the end of this session. I am going to pause the committee till 11:15 to allow a changeover of witnesses and to allow us to prepare for the next item. Thank you and your officials for attending this morning. And you're going to stay, so we'll see you shortly, Cabinet Secretary. I suspend the meeting till 11:15. Thank you. Welcome back. Our next item of business is an evidence session on a Type 1 consent notification on the Persistent Organic Pollutants Amendment Regulations 2023. This is a UK statutory instrument where the UK government is seeking the Scottish government's consent to legislate in an area of devolved competence. On the 18th of June, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Net Zero and Just Transition notified the committee of the UKSI. The Scottish Government asked if the committee could exceptionally consider this by the 28th of June in order to complete our parliamentary consideration before the summer recess. I therefore agreed to place the item on the agenda for this meeting. The committee's role is to decide whether it agrees with the Scottish Government's proposal to consent to the UK Government making these regulations within the devolved competence and in the manner which the UK Government has indicated to the Scottish Government. After today's evidence session, we aim to come to a view on this, and I'm pleased to welcome back Mary McCallum, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Net Zero and Just Transition, joined by Dan Merkel, the Chemicals Team Leader for the Scottish Government. Before we move on to questions, Cabinet Secretary, I think you want to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and I will be as brief as I can, although sometimes with complex matters like this, I think it's helpful to try and set out in clearest terms possible what we're discussing. So this is the proposed UK statutory instrument to extend the expiry date for a specific use of a chemical called PFOA, that is a persistent organic pollutant which is regulated under the UK POPs regulation. The purpose of this SI is to extend the expiry date from 4th July 2023 to 3 December 25 to allow the continued use of the PFOA in specialist textiles for oil and water repellency for the protection of workers from dangerous liquids that comprise a risk to health and safety. So by way of very brief background, the UK POPs regulation implements the Stockholm Convention in the UK. POPs, again, persistent organic pollutants, are chemicals that remain intact in the environment for long periods, become widely distributed geographically, accumulate in the tissues of humans and wildlife, and have harmful impacts on human health or the environment. They therefore present a risk to the environment and people that extends beyond national borders, and therefore we require a coordinated response. So this chemical, commonly known as PFOA, was listed as a POP under the Convention in 2019 and is subject, therefore, to elimination. This means it cannot be made, imported, sold or used in signatory countries. Several time-limited exemptions are included in its listing, reflecting the continued need for its use in a number of critical applications in signatory countries, and it's one such use that is subject that is the subject of this UKSI. The use is required for a chemical, for a defence critical capability. The use is small, it's critical, and the chemical is used and disposed of by professionals. So, having considered matters, I am happy that this use presents a very low risk to the environment. I am less happy about the timeframe that the Scottish Government has been asked to respond and the consequent impact of that on the committee. But I do understand that there were good reasons for this, and ministers and officials in the UK Government alerted us as soon as they were able to. So the committee should note that the UK Government is having to break its own 21-day rule to lay this instrument. But in summary, whilst I apologise for the delay, I do consider that consenting to this UKSI is an appropriate course of action to follow. Continued access to critical defence function and its availability across GB, including Scotland.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and I'm happy to take questions, or you will, I'm sure, Cabinet Secretary. First one comes from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks very much for that. Am I right in saying that this is what's known as a forever chemical, and these are getting banned under the REACH regulations? Is that right? So is this one that's scheduled for effectively withdrawal from the market under REACH?
Yes,
is
I mean.
Right?
Sorry. No, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Go on.
No, I'm done.
Yes, so I think the word I used in my opening remarks was it's scheduled for elimination, but I'll let Dan maybe give us a brief update on that in the context of PFAS. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning, Committee. Yes, so this is one of the few PFAS chemicals that have actually already been banned. There are just quite a small number of those, and this is one that's subject to complete elimination under the Stockholm Convention. So the work you refer to in the UK is much broader, and it's looking at PFAS as a whole, which are a class of, depending on how you count them, more than 4,700 chemicals in total. And the Health and Safety Executive, who are the agency for the UK REACH regulation, they published something called a risk management options analysis earlier this year that gave recommendations for how to regulate these chemicals as a whole. And those actions are going to be taken forward, starting with work this year under UK REACH that will shortly be published.
Okay, so
before you ask the next question, there was one point you made in there which I don't think it answered, and it would be helpful, I think, for the committee to know. You said withdrawn from, I think, the market. That it's not a market, is it? It's one specific use. Is that not correct?
Yes, we're just talking about one specific use today here, that is a current exemption under the UK POPS regulation.
So it's not being sold, yeah.
Sorry. Okay, but generally speaking, PFOA is not available within a wider market. It's just this single exemption that we're discussing today. So can I just turn to that then? I mean, is it the case that there are exemptions that are applied for by Ministry of Defence or defence-related contractors within that industry for environmental regulation? Because on the face of it, like if you're wearing protective clothing and you're a civil contractor, then the use of this chemical in that protective clothing would be banned. Whereas if you're working in a defence-related sector or industry, then its continued use is allowed. So it feels that there is a bit of a divergence there between people who are working in defence-related industries and people who are working in civilian areas where they don't have this exemption for this chemical. So it might be a minor sort of divergence there, but I'm just wondering how those issues get discussed, resolved. Is it something that you just have to accept that, well, this is the decision the UK government's made on this one, or is there a protocol with the MOD or defence sector more generally around, you know, lower or different environmental standards?
So, Dan, you might want to say something about interaction with UK government and MOD. I suppose what makes this difficult is that we're limited in the information that we can give regarding the specific use. It's a defence critical capability, it's small, it's critical, and the chemical is used and disposed of by professionals. So it pertains to the specific use, the exact details of which we're not liable to share. But the other critical point is that the current scientific research suggests that only this substance provides the high level of protection that's required for this unique capability, and that's why it's required in this instance to give the exemption.
Okay,
there might be nothing to add on MOD. You might want to.
It's getting phased out by 25 anyway, is that right?
That's the plan,
right.
Yes.
Okay.
Are you happy with that, or do you want to hear from Dan?
Unless Dan has anything more.
The only thing I would perhaps add is that PFOA is still also restricted under UK REACH. So when that restriction was put in place, and it includes very similar provisions to those of the Stockholm Convention, there was a thorough consultation in the EU, because we were still in the EU at that time, and that's where this date of the 4th of July 2023 comes from. So for those other kind of uses that you referred to, and emphasising that we're not, you know, entirely clear on the exact use, but we don't need to know that, I think, from the point of view of environmental risk. For these other uses, there are alternatives that will be sufficient for the application in question.
Okay, that's me.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you, convener. Cabinet Secretary, just to ask, I think you said that only this particular substance, this PFOA, can be used. There's not a substitute. There's not an alternative. So what happens on the 3rd December 2025? Does the need for it just disappear, or does the UK government move away from its Stockholm obligations, or has that conversation been had with the UK government?
So I wouldn't expect either of those to come to pass. The reason the exemption is the extension is required just now is that the technical progress on an alternative hasn't reached a sufficient stage, as I understand it. And I would expect that this would focus the work on that technical alternative and would give the time to have it developed. That's our expectation anyway.
Well, it's odd kind of scrutinising in the dark a little bit, Cabinet Secretary, but I appreciate what you say in relation to that. The papers always talk about, from the government, but continued use is required for a defence critical capability. The use is small, critical, and the chemical is used and disposed of by professionals. Have you had reassurances from the UK government over the monitoring and reporting of that to make sure that there are robust protocols in place rather than the assertion that there's robust protocols in place?
Yeah, it's probably, I think the thing to say is to emphasise that it's a continuation of a use that they already have. So I'm not aware of what the specific monitoring and reporting requirements would be, but all we're doing here is changing the deadline for that use to stop. So everything that's in place currently to make sure the chemicals used safely will continue.
Yeah, I'm not minded to oppose this. I get this is based on trust as much as anything, but I just wanted to ask those questions to get some of that on the record. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. Are there any other questions? No. So that's helpful. We're now going to go on and consider the consent notification. Cabinet Secretary, as you've answered all the questions that you've been asked, I'm very content if you'd like to leave at this stage.
Sure.
And I thank you again for your attendance for both sessions this morning.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so agenda item 4 is to formally consider the Type 1 consent notification by the Scottish Government relating to the Persistent Organic Pollutants Amendment Regulations 2023 in light of the evidence that we've just heard. The question is if members are members are content for consent to be given, we could just write to the Scottish Government. We could ask them to keep us up to date on developments at a reasonable stage in the future, but we could also write to them and say we're not content. Can I just ask at this stage, is anyone on the committee not content to grant consent for this? So we're all content to ask. I think it would therefore be appropriate if the committee agreed that we're asked to be updated in perhaps a year's time to find out how we're moving forward on finding an alternative to this. That might be the most appropriate thing to do. Is the committee content for that, Mark?
Yeah, I'm content with that course of action. I mean, it is a slightly odd situation in that because of the defence-related nature of the chemicals use, there is a lack of transparency there. And I think, you know, Bob's points there are well made. I think perhaps there is an issue going forward about ensuring that, you know, there is that adequate opportunity for scrutinising how the Ministry of Defence apply environmental management and more wider kind of health and safety requirements. So, yes, we are taking it on trust that, you know, there's a defence-related use of this chemical. It will be dealt with in a responsible way, but, you know, there's no real way for us to scrutinise that. So I think that's just worth, you know, putting on record. And this isn't the only area I've come across in this committee and predecessor committees where environmental regulation has come up against a defence exemption. And therein, you know, you're sort of left wondering, you know, what the actual protocols and protections are for workers and the environment within the Ministry of Defence and related industries.
So we could, as part of writing to the Scottish Government, say to them that we'd like to be kept updated and we'd like a comment from them whether they feel that there are sufficient protocols in for the disposal after use. Are continued. We can easily do that as part of the letter.
My understanding is that in the past there has been a memorandum of understanding between Scottish Government and Ministry of Defence over a range of different areas, you know, most notably you know, environmental compliance, habitats regulations, environmental management, that side of things. This is obviously straying more into the health and safety areas, but I think, you know, there clearly is environmental compliance within the Ministry of Defence, but scrutinising it is pretty hard. And this is another example of that which comes up from time to time.
Okay. Sorry, Bob. Yeah.
I just think it's actually a very helpful discussion. As part of any letter going back, convener, it would be worth just making the point that if such protocols have previously existed, just what the current situation is, and have they given consideration previously, or could they do in the future, to how committees in this Parliament can get appropriate scrutiny in relation to look at some of these matters? Because I'm sure we all agree it's absolutely necessary, but deeply unsatisfactory that this is being proposed within days of the expiration, and there's no really meaningful scrutiny. It has all been taken on trust.
Okay, I think I take that point, and I think the committee could easily write under a separate letter to the government to ask to identify that. But I'm going to move to a substantive question to the committee, which is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be made to the proposed UK statutory instrument? We are agreed, so we will communicate that to the government. So that concludes our public meeting, and then we now move into private session. Thank you.